This presentation examines Little Singletary Lake in North Carolina, which is in an area where many of the geological principles of superposition can be observed in the emplacement of the Carolina Bays. Also, several sources of error are identified in dating the bays using optically stimulated luminescence, or OSL. Welcome to another edition of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacier ice boulders that were ejected by one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide ice sheet. Today we will examine Little Singletary Lake, which is located 28 kilometers or 17 miles southeast of Fayetteville, North Carolina. This area has a river, a creek, mud splashes, erosion, and overlapping bays that can be explained by several geological mechanisms. In 2017, I proposed that the elliptical geometry of the Carolina Bays implies that these basins originated as inclined conical cavities or penetration funnels made by secondary impacts of glacier ice. This makes sense because ellipses are conic sections. Of course, not all Carolina Bays are elliptical, but many of the distortions can be attributed to the formations caused by the properties of the terrain or to erosion by wind and water after the basins were formed. The formation of the Carolina Bays by impacts has been considered since the 1930s when the bays were first photographed by aerial surveys, but today, mainstream geologists attribute the formation of the bays to gradualistic wind and water mechanisms which operated over thousands of years. This conclusion is based mainly on the result of dating the terrain by optically stimulated luminescence, or OSL. We will start by getting familiar with the neighborhood of Little Singletary Lake. I'm using the LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth by Michael Davies. There's a link to it in the description of the video. The Cape Fear River and Harrison Creek are located to the west of Little Singletary Lake. One of the first things that we notice in this landscape is that the area with the river has just a few bays on the high ground between the river and the creek, whereas the area away from the river has many Carolina bays. The lack of bays along the fluvial channels brings up the question of whether the entire surface was bombarded equally by the glacier ice boulders ejected by the extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. This is actually a trick question. It is almost like asking if rivers get wet when it rains, but we know that rain falls not only on the land, but on the rivers also. The ejecta curtain from the extraterrestrial impact would have deposited a fairly uniform distribution of ice projectiles in the area of 20 by 30 kilometers represented by this image. The Carolina Bays are fragile sandy structures that are easily eroded by horizontal water flow, so we have to conclude that the Cape Fear River with all its meanders and the Harrison Creek destroyed most of the Carolina Bays that existed in that part of the landscape. One thing is to be able to deduce that there were impacts along the Cape Fear River, and another is to be able to prove it. So how do we know that there were impacts on the Cape Fear River and Harrison Creek? We look for splashes of river sediment. In this enlarged image, we see the mud splashes, also called splash chevrons, which were created when sediment from the river and the creek was carried to higher terrain by wave action. The impact of an ice projectile on a riverbed drenches the sediment and deposits it on higher terrain as illustrated here. Splash chevrons are found on many coastal areas around the world. The V-shaped sand deposits along the shoreline of southern Madagascar are thought to have been created by tsunamis produced by tectonic activity that picked up sand from the shallow seabed and brought it to higher ground. Some scientists have suggested that extraterrestrial impacts in the ocean could also have generated such tsunamis to produce the splash chevrons. Little Singletary Lake also has a splash chevron. This probably resulted from a small lake that was hit by the glacier ice boulder that made this basin. The chevron does not have high contrast in the LiDAR image because it is very thin. The splash chevron can be seen more clearly in the satellite image because the white sand of the splash contrasts against the darker background of the surface. Notice that there are actually two splash chevrons by Little Singletary Lake. Marshy Bay, which is to the northeast of Little Singletary Lake, has attracted attention before because it overlays several Carolina bays that are around it. In 2006, the book by Richard Firestone, Alan West, and Simon Warwick Smith introduced the Younger Dryas impact hypothesis and brought attention to Marshy Bay and a cluster of bays in North Carolina with overlapping rims. The book says, "Notice the fish scale effect at the arrows, where a top bay overlaps a middle one, which overlaps a lower one. Of the 11 bays, 10 overlap others or are overlapped. Wind or water cannot create this effect, whereas an impact can." This image highlights the sediment deposits made by the splashes of impacts on Harrison Creek. The deposits cover a strip of land almost 2 kilometers wide along the bank of the creek. These splash deposits attest to the bombardment on the creek. Note that the bays labeled A, B, and C cut neatly into the splash sediment. This means that these bays were emplaced after the splashes were deposited. In the case of Bay A, we can see that the sand deposit stopped abruptly at the margin of the bay, which confirms the deposition sequence. First, the sand sheet was deposited, and then an impact made Bay A, according to the law of superposition. We can also see that the Little Singletary Lake Basin was made before the bay labeled A, because the rim of Bay A spilled into the Singletary Basin. At the beginning of this presentation, I mentioned that the mainstream geologists attribute the formation of the bays to gradualistic wind and water mechanisms. Searching Google for the dates of the Carolina bays, the first answer that comes back says, quote, "The dating of the sand rims of a number of Carolina bays by optically stimulated luminescence OSL techniques has yielded ages ranging from about 109,000 to 2,000 years ago, but most ages from the sand rims range from about 40,000 to 11,000 years ago," end quote. The information comes from Wikipedia, so we can question its validity. However, peer-reviewed publications, like this one by Lundin and Trembanis, published in 2021, say this about the Carolina bays. Quote, "Many have argued, without substantial evidence, that they are meteoritic, comet, or glacial ice impact craters, while others have tried to explain their origin using slower geological processes tied to wind, waves, burning peat, and groundwater processes. Sediments collected from Carolina bays have returned ages ranging from over 100,000 years old to within the last 5,000 years, indicating that these features have undergone numerous stages of genesis and modification. The exact details of their dynamics, however, remain unclear." End quote. The paper seems to favor wind and water mechanisms for the formation of the Carolina bays because it mentions that there is no substantial evidence for the impact hypothesis. The wide range of dates from over 100,000 to 5,000 years ago also seems like a reasonable argument against the origin of the Carolina bays during a single event until you examine the limitations of optically stimulated luminescence dating. The Geology Department of Utah State University has detailed instructions for collecting soil samples for dating by optically stimulated luminescence. The optically stimulated luminescence OSL technique dates the last time sediments were exposed to sunlight, which zeroes the luminescence signal. The luminescence signal grows with time due to exposure to radioactive isotopes within the sediment and incoming cosmic rays. The H is calculated by dividing the dose the sample received by the dose rate of its depositional environments. OSL is a very accurate dating technique when the proper sampling instructions are followed. One of the instructions for OSL dating says to avoid sampling less than 1 meter below the land surface due to difficulties in determining cosmic dose rate. This requirement is probably responsible for the worst errors in dating the Carolina bays. This image of the Murray Spring Clovis site in Arizona shows the black mat that dates to 12,900 years ago, which is the time of the Younger Dryas Cataclysm that has been proposed as the time when the Carolina bays formed by secondary impacts of glacier ice boulders ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. Notice that the black mat is about 2 feet or about 60 centimeters below the land surface. Any OSL samples taken 1 meter below the surface would be far deeper than the surface of 12,900 years ago. This will cause the OSL dates to correspond to terrain that is thousands of years older than the time of bay formation. Another requirement for OSL sampling is to avoid bioturbated sediments that have been moved around by burrowing animals or by plant roots. The instructions clearly say that it is best to only sample sediments where you can see primary sedimentary structures. The accuracy of OSL depends on sampling layers of undisturbed soil deposited by sedimentary processes. This also implies that OSL should not be used on soil disturbed by the barrage of impacts that created the Carolina bays. Unfortunately, the Carolina bays have been dated by OSL as if they were sedimentary structures, and this has produced a wide range of invalid dates that have been used to argue that the Carolina bays did not form contemporaneously. Optically stimulated luminescence dating was intended for use on sedimentary structures, and it is inappropriate to use it on a landscape formed by a barrage of impacts that scrambled the terrain. Little Singletary Lake is located 1,111 kilometers from Lake Michigan, which is assumed to be the point from which the ice boulder that made the basin was launched. The basin has a width of 1,707 meters and a length of 2,905 meters. With a length of almost 3 kilometers, Little Singletary Lake is not so little. The width-to-length ratio corresponds to an impact angle of 36.0 degrees. The diameter of the glacier ice projectile that made the basin is estimated to be 581 meters, which is one-fifth of the basin length. The smaller Bay A is slightly more circular, and it corresponds to an impact angle of 37.0 degrees. The ballistic equations indicate that the glacier ice boulder that made Little Singletary Lake was launched at a speed of 3.385 kilometers per second. It had a flight time of 406 seconds and reached a height of 202 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. The trajectory was a suborbital spaceflight in the vacuum of space. Notice that the ice boulder that made the small bay labeled A arrived 7 seconds after the ice boulder that made Little Singletary Lake. From the LiDAR image, we already know that small bay A overlaps Little Singletary Lake, but the geometry of the bay used to calculate the impact angle and the ballistic equations confirm the sequence in which the impacts were made. The kinetic energy of the impact that made Little Singletary Lake was equivalent to 129 megatons of TNT, which would have caused seismic vibrations of magnitude 8.89. The small bay A was made by an impact with energy of 58 megatons of TNT. The features of this landscape can be explained fairly well by assuming that the Carolina Bays originated as inclined conical cavities produced by oblique impacts. The transformation of the conical cavities into shallow elliptical bays by viscous relaxation can be demonstrated by a physical model. The splash chevrons adjacent to the river and the overlapping bays can also be explained as the result of ballistic sedimentation of ice boulders ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. The impact model of the Carolina Bays can account for all the geological features. However, it would be very difficult to explain all the details of this landscape if we assume that the Carolina Bays were created by wind and water mechanisms. The greatest challenge would be to describe the physical forces by which wind and water could consistently make shallow depressions with nearly elliptical geometry, including in cases where the bays overlap. In addition, wind and water mechanisms cannot explain why the basins from Nebraska to the East Coast have radial alignment toward the Great Lakes. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays.